So as you mentioned, so in fact this presentation is based on a paper. You had the working paper version, and it was an updated version of this book that has been published only in French. So the book itself, I will go directly to the article, but the book itself, if you feel interested by the topic and able to read in French, the book was a kind of macroeconomic overview of the Japanese economy during the since the early 90s, and you remember that the early 90s correspond to the beginning of what has been called the lost decade in Japan. More precisely, the paper I will present today is an introduction about economic policy in the age of globalization. So I hope you might be interested by the topic, and I hope I will be able to convince you that the Japanese case is particularly relevant to the study of this general question. And I think in Japan, like in Europe, in the US, and many other countries, governments are facing a series of dilemmas regarding different dimensions of the crisis, banking crisis, fiscal deficit, and structural reform issues. And from this viewpoint, Japan is not at all exotic, despite some, of course, specific institutions, specific political context, and I really hope you will learn from this. For many economists, the Japan case is in fact very simple. The problem with Japan is not a problem with economic thought, it's just a problem with the economic government. So just change the government, make the politician better, and Japan will be back on the track of steady growth and so on. And we have been quite inspired by this quote from Paul Krugman, which is exactly 20 years ago, and we fully agree with him. The Japanese case in the early 90s shows how much maybe there are, of course, some responsibilities on the politician side, on the government side, but it shows, first of all, that the limitation of our tools for analysis and understanding economic crisis. So it's, I think, for you and for us, it's even more exciting to try to look at the Japanese case with the eyes of an economist and to try to understand what happened and why it has been so difficult to recover from stagnation. Of course, you were not born for most, none of you were born at that time, but remember that in the mid-80s, the best economists in the world were predicting that the 90s and the 21st century would be Japanese or would not be. So it was obvious that Japan would catch up with the US and would become the number one economy in the world. No discussion about it. And for the young economists, US-based economists, they were advised, okay, you don't have to learn Japanese to become a real specialist of Japan, but at least if you are ambitious, if you want to become professor in one of the top universities, you should at least write a paper on US trade deficit with Japan or any keiretsu or something. So it was really the future for the world economy, but also for the profession of economist. And we should be modest after 30 years, maybe there were something we did not understand, and I'm afraid that for many of us, including myself, there are many things we do not yet understand. So what we, this is a general background. More precisely, the purpose of the presentation is to propose an evaluation of Abenomics, this economic policy experience that started in late 2011, early 2012, after Mr. Abe became prime minister again. So it has been more than, it's December 2012. December 2012, and the economic experience started a few weeks later. So it's about 5 years. And with my colleague and friend Brieux Montfort, we have tried to follow up this experience and to provide evaluation. To tell you the truth, our own evaluation has been evolving from year to year, because it's very difficult to evaluate a concrete economic policy experience. Our starting point is the following. We have looked at different types of evolution of so-called Abenomics. Again, Abenomics is an economic policy introduced by Prime Minister Abe in Japan. Some of them are very well theoretically grounded. It's really a beautiful evaluation based on theoretical tools for economics, but it rarely incorporates concrete aspect of government, government history in Japan, government institution. It does not say so much about economic history in Japan during the 20 years. And I think it's missing in most of the evaluation of Abenomics. Very difficult to think that you can be in your room, look at the macro data of Japan and deliver a B, or even a E if you think it's not good at all. And so you need to incorporate economic history and institution. On the other hand, we have discussed and we have read many papers written by Japanese economists or commentators on Japan, and many of them are, again, we are disturbed in reading them because they pay maybe too much attention at the figure of Mr. Abe. And I will not discuss about it today, it's not the purpose, but you should be aware that Mr. Abe is really at the extreme right of the political spectrum in Japan, which is, by comparison to what you observe in Europe, already switched to the right. And what I will say it once, but we can discuss it later, it's very surprising that Mr. Abe gave his name to economic policy experience, because he is not at all interested in economics, he's not at all an economist, he was just well advised. His goal, his political goal, is to change the Japanese constitution, to put an end to the post-war period that was dominated by pacifism. So economics is just a tool, and so this political figure is highly controversial. So we need to know this, but it should not disturb so much the evaluation. And final problem we found in the evaluation, which is not proper to Abenomics, it's what we may call short-termism. So as soon as the quarterly data are available for output or prices, are they good or bad? You will see a very dramatic comment saying that it shows that this is a success of Abenomics, or it shows it's a deep failure of Abenomics. So we should calm down a little. So now we are after 5 years, and I think we can have a quite moderate, but nonetheless, we try to be very close to the data, evaluation of what has been the outcome of Abenomics. It's important for Japan. I will try to convince you it's also very important for Europe, for the US, and other countries. So, because it's quite important experience of economic policy. So, what we do in the paper, myself, I would define myself as an institutionalist economist. I was trained in the framework of regulation theory. So I have my own theoretical framework, and I will show you this a little. I will propose a structuralist and institutionalist perspective on the Japanese economy that was present in the book you cited, published in 2014, The Great Transformation of Japanese Capitalism. But basically, we try to refer to standard tools of economics and to see what we can conclude from this in terms of impact of monetary policy, fiscal policy, and structural reform. At the same time, it's not a OECD report, so we try to input something which is connected to our theoretical perspective. So the evaluation of Abenomics has evolved. But basically, I would say that these days, dominant common wisdom is to say it's a failure. It's not a big failure, but it's a failure. And the two major arguments are the following. One is Abenomics failed to fight significantly against deflation. So it means that it's a confirmation that monetary policy does not work, and some economists, and you may guess who among them says this, some economists will add monetary policy never work. So forget about it. So they use Abenomics as a case for this. And the second argument, very classical, Abenomics failed because he did not commit enough to structural reform. And again, you know very well who is concluding this. And in fact, the conclusion was already written before the experience starts, because for some economists, you will never do enough structural reform. So it's whatever you do, they need more. It's like, you know, junkies. They always need more drugs. Our argument is the following. Indeed, Abenomics did less than expected, than Abe expected himself in terms of output and price dynamics. Nonetheless, it's difficult to say that it's a failure. There are some positive outcome of this experience, and also we did not do a very rigorous counterfactual. I hope to give you some intuition about what would have been the current stage of the Japanese economy without this kind of very aggressive economic policy. And let me give my own definition of Abenomics. There are two definitions. One is Abenomics, Abe with a capital letter, so it's a political project, and the intuition that to reach the objective of the political project, get some support from the citizen. You know that elections in Japan are almost as often than in the US, so there is a strong pressure on government that before Abe changed more than every year. He was convinced that in providing a certain level of output, his popularity rate, his support rate, would be enough to pass a certain number of reforms. This is what I said. I put this aside, and I will focus on another definition. And this definition is very simple. To me, Abenomics is just an alternative to austerity. Basically, government, these days, they have two options. I'm exaggerating a little. One is austerity. One is something similar to Abenomics. And if you have a better name than Abenomics, which is not completely satisfying. Please tell me after my talk. So more than 5 years later, it's interesting to see that the most optimistic forecast of Abenomics were not met, but the most dramatic forecast of complete collapse of Abenomics did not happen as well. So it might be a little disappointing, but just Japanese economy continue to grow at a slow level. We did this kind of exercise. Here, you can see in this slide, we try to find, to define a forecast done in spring 2013 based on IMF forecasts, OECD forecasts. So it's a kind of consensus of different forecasts that were done in spring 2013 for Japan, US, and France. This is the blue line, okay? And before 2013, it means it's not a forecast, it's the real term. And we did the same exercise with a similar forecast by the same institution in spring 2016. And the conclusion is that in the case of Japan, it's much below the initial forecast, okay? But when you compare with the US and France, you see that France, the forecast, in fact, was not so good, so it's relatively close to what was expected. And in the case of the US, it's far below. So the results in Japan are disappointing, but relatively similar to what happened in the US, except the fact that the outcome is much better in the US than in Japan, still in terms of GDP growth. Let me warn you. You may have absolutely no image about the Japanese economy during the last 30 years. And I think it's better to have absolutely no image than similar image than our good friend Larry Summers, well known for his very sophisticated opinion and very nuanced opinion. So you may, of course, accept, consider that it's true, Japan is an aging society. It's also true that the number of migrants in Japan is very much limited by comparison to the US or Europe, but nonetheless, I would be very careful with this kind of very quick conclusion. Let me give you two examples to show that we need to be careful. We, in the book and in the paper, we review several ideas that we took from the conventional wisdom. One is that Japan experienced zero growth over the past 25 years. And it's true that if you look at the nominal GDP from the early 90s, the contrast is really sharp between Japan, which is the dark line, and on the other side, the United States and Europe. The question is nominal GDP the right criterion to look at growth, to compare growth amongst these three countries and regions? We do not think so because of deflation in Japan and also because of divergent demographic trend in these three countries and regions. So what we have to do is to look at real GDP and to make it per capita. And if you do so, and if you put US as the point of comparison, you will see that, in fact, the trajectory of Japan is very similar to the one in Europe from the viewpoint of GDP per capita. And so the thing to understand is why the convergence towards the US has stopped in Europe and in Japan. Is there a limit around 30% that cannot be overcome? Second idea. It's taken from one of the worst articles I have ever read during the last 20 years on Japan by James Nikon, US-based economist. He called the stage of Japanese economy in early 2000 as arthritic Japan. So again, the idea is the idea of structural reform. If a given country is not adopting the institution of US capitalism, it is sure that this country will fail. And in the book you mentioned, I try to show that, in fact, Japan, since the early 80s, introduced a lot of structural reform. And maybe my hypothesis is that this structural reform maybe are a part of the reason why Japan entered into a structural crisis. So quite a different perspective. I will skip and just introduce what I will have to say within the time I have. So try again to define quickly the novelty and the continuity of Abenomics, to look at Abenomics in the short run, and to propose you an interpretation of the long run perspective of the Japanese economy and impact of Abenomics. So I started to give my own definition, but the standard definition of Abenomics is a combination of a coordinated combination of several tools of economic policy that are normally these days disconnected because different government bodies or institutions are in charge of these different economic tools. And by itself is interesting. So first aspect is monetary policy with the aim of exiting deflation. So the role of monetary policy is to find a way out from deflation, and there were several waves, QQE, QQE2, QQE with negative interest rates. Another second dimension, which is coordinated with the first one, is flexible fiscal policy. What does it mean? Basically, it's a program of fiscal consolidation. You know that the public debt in Japan represents these days more than 200 of the GDP, 200% of the GDP, twice the GDP. It would take more than 2 years to produce, to use the whole production in Japan to reimburse the public debt. Theoretically. So there is certainly a necessity to start reimbursing at least a part of this debt. But the way it has been done in Japan has been, what we may say, very flexible, or at least in sharp contrast with what has been followed in the European context. Okay. The major tool that has been used is increase of the value added tax, and as you will see, it has been increased very moderately. Third dimension, this is the so-called structural reform. And basically, in the case of Abenomics, it's very simple. This is a policy focusing on private investment as a major engine for growth. We may cite corporate governance reform, several free trade agreements, and the Trans-Pacific Partnership. I will introduce them a little. Later on, so because it's lasting for more than 5 years, Mr. Abe has introduced several other measures, including so-called womanomics, the promotion of women at work, but I will not discuss this so much, but I will be, of course, very happy to have a discussion with you later on it. Alors, with which meaning we consider that Abenomics is an innovation? First, there are two reasons. One, and maybe I should start with it, it's a conceptual break in terms of monetary policy. Of course, this conceptual break is not isolated. At the same time than Abenomics, the European Central Bank and other institutions are trying to introduce similar policies. It's not unique, but when you look at the massive injection of money in the economy and the fact that for more than two decades, the interest rate in Japan is about zero, I would say that it's extreme case of maybe the new norm in terms of monetary policy. What is particularly interesting to me is the coordination of different economic policy tools, and I will spend a little more time on this because there is institutional situation you should be aware of. So formally, the Bank of Japan, the Central Bank of Japan called BOJ, is independent. It was created in the late 19th century. It's one of the first central banks to be created. And formally, it was independent. But in reality, until 1997, it was under the strict domination of the Minister of Finance. So Minister of Finance was calling the governor of BOJ, telling him what he should do. Okay? After 1997, and in a context when many people thought that Ministry of Finance was responsible for the structural crisis of the 90s in Japan, the BOJ got its real substantial independence. Is it good or not? I have no opinion. But what I see is in this particular institutional context, we had a new situation that we can characterize as independence trap. So as you know, central bankers, they have to build their reputation. And in a specific context, which was 1997, do you remember what happened in 1997? And the Asian crisis. So it has nothing to do at the beginning with the Japanese economy. It was a crisis of emerging countries in Asia. But as you can imagine, Japan was deeply affected by the crisis. So exactly at the time of this crisis, the BOJ decided to increase interest rate and to say, we don't care. We have our own agenda. We don't care about the global situation or the priority of Japanese government. So for almost until the arrival of Abe, as the prime minister in 2012, BOJ was trying to build its credibility based on a very strict policy. With relatively, then they changed the policy and they put interest rate close to zero, but it was really independently from what has the government. So it's, to me, very interesting case of the limitation of the independence of a central bank. As for the monetary policy, maybe I will keep it for the discussion, but there were several, the new monetary policy did not start with Abe, there were several attempts, but maybe not so clear direction. Besides this innovation, there are some continuity. One is what I mentioned as a flexible fiscal policy. In fact, it's not so new, and that's why Japan has accumulated so huge government public debt. Except during the period of Prime Minister Koizumi, there were several attempts to consolidate the budget, but in a very flexible way, to say the least. In terms of structural reform, Abe has introduced a lot of structural reform. So what I call structural reform is very clear. Some reform leading to the liberalization of the economy. And I would say that the inspiration is very close to the one of President Macron in France. So basically, major structural reform have been done. So it's a kind of catalogue of minor reform. Maybe not so sexy, not so impressive, but what can they do? They liberalize everything. So maybe except agriculture and immigration. So now, time for evaluation in the short run. First, and of course this is not the major target, but it's a medium target. One thing is the evaluation of the yen. As you can briefly see here on the graph, after the Plaza Agreement, so at the time in the mid-80s, the yen to the dollar was under-evaluated, and it was considered as a problem for the US. And after the Plaza Agreement, there is a process of correction and maybe overshooting. And so from the mid-90s, we enter a period of over-evaluation of the yen. And thanks to Abe, and thanks to the very aggressive monetary policy, we consider that this is the end of over-evaluation of the yen, which is a good news if you want to fight against deflation and in terms of the international channel of deflation. Another good news is that after Abe became prime minister, we observe a boost of equity returns. And if you look at the Nikkei index, you see that it's increasing. Also, during 20 years, it was really stagnant. And the credit in the economy has increased. You have more options to find, to get credit, especially when you are a large company. So it's good, but it's not the target per itself. What about price dynamics? I did not update. This is a little better recently, but basically the story we have in mind is the following. The price increase is still very low and sometimes negative. So we cannot consider that Abe succeeded in getting out from deflation. But these numbers that are not fantastic should be corrected in taking into account the decrease of the price of energy and fresh food over a certain period covering Abenomics. So it's not excellent, far from being excellent, and very far from the initial target of Abe, but not that bad. What becomes more problematic is what happened on the labor market. And what happened on the labor market will affect also, of course, your price dynamics. One thing that may make you dreaming, it depends from which country you are, but from a French perspective, it's like going on the moon or even farther. Current unemployment rate in Japan is 2.4. Of course, the maximum since the early 90s was 6.0. But still, if you compare with the US and other countries, it's excellent performance, which in fact does not depend only on Abenomics. What is less funny is the wage growth. If you don't know the meaning of flat, please look at the wage curve in Japan. It has been really flat since the early 90s. No increase of nominal wage since the early 90s. And to us, it's one major reason why it's so difficult to boost price dynamics and output. As for private investment and consumption, we have a kind of paradox, but which is not limited to Japan. We observe records of corporate profit and very high cash ratios, a ratio of 40% against 15 or 30% in other OECD countries, but very cautious investment behavior. And we do not observe a rebound. And as for consumption, which was not the target of Abenomics, and which is obvious, it's also very, very flat. So failure from this perspective. So let's adopt a more longer perspective within the 7 minutes I still have to conclude my talk. I prefer to anticipate and to give myself additional 5 minutes just in case. So what we should consider that, so obviously in terms of growth, in terms of price dynamics, again, Abenomics did not reach the target. And what is important to understand is, if possible, to try to separate between what is relevant to Abenomics itself and what is relevant to the international context. And you know that these days, Mr. Macron in France is celebrating the success of his economic policy. He has arrived 1 year ago, but he considers that his economic policy is already a success. We may also consider that he is a very lucky man, and which is good for him, but he is benefiting from maybe a past policy, and even more importantly, from a global context which is favorable. In the case of Japan, more recently, the global context is not bad, but it's true that in Asia, especially in 2015-2016, growth has not been as high as expected. And there was a big problem for Mr. Abe. He did not forecast this at all, and neither myself nor you. The election of Mr. Trump put an end to the TPP, the Trans-Pacific Partnership. So it was the core of Mr. Abe's strategy to reboot the economy. But when you want to make a free trade agreement, you need a partner. And the major partner disappeared. Of course, they are all the TPP is still alive, but without the US, it's a little problematic. To be more precise, in fact, Hillary Clinton himself promised to get out from this TPP. At least it was a promise. We don't know if she would have enforced it. But so a part is independent from Abenomics, but a part is really related to Abenomics. One is the fact that Abenomics has many programs, including Mr. Macron program or Miss Merkel program during the last 5 years. There is no focus on consumption and no idea that inequalities may affect growth in the long run. And in the case of Japan, there are some tools that are still available, including tax policy. And if you want, I may develop this point, because it seems that in Japan, there is really a taboo on tax policy, and I have some anecdotes on this. Basically, the only tool which is used is consumption tax, which is certainly not enough. As for structural reform, so contrary to the conventional wisdom, Abe has been very active in structural reform. We cite several reforms, and I will be able to enter into the detail during the discussion if you are interested. But this is at least as active as the experience under Prime Minister Koizumi in the mid-2000s, which is known as the king of structural reform in Japan. So here is my, we are close to the end of my talk within 2 minutes. What we consider is that nonetheless, so the problem, there are some problems in the short run, but the problem is rather on the long run, and the problem is in the definition of the structural reform. Before promoting structural reform, you should define what you have in mind in terms of a growth regime. It means that you have to answer a certain number of questions. Do you want the growth of your economy lie on export, exclusively on export, or also on internal demand? And what should be the balance between consumer and private investment? And finally, how to define, and as you know, it's particularly important in the Japanese context after Fukushima, how to define a growth regime with limited negative externalities on the environment. I did not see any debate related to these questions in Abenomics or in Japan in general during the last 5 or 10 years. Why Abenomics may fail to restore the growth path of Japan, the common wisdom says it's very simple. It's because of aging. The population in Japan is decreasing, so they cannot expect high growth. They cannot expect even growth at the level of OECD. It's a unique case among OECD countries. The decrease of population in absolute term and decrease of working population. To us, demography is important, but as you know, it's not the major engine of growth for modern economies. Another hypothesis is a lack of innovation. And when you look at the type of innovations that are introduced in Japan every year, when you look one side on Nobel Prize, but also innovations that are introduced in key companies, it's hard to think that this country is not innovating. What we found in a past research that was introduced in the Great Transformation of Japanese Capitalism is not the lack of innovation, but the lack of diffusion of reform. And this graph that describes a panel of 10,000 manufacturing companies report increasing productivity gap between the top companies and the average and bottom companies. So the very good companies, they still have very high productivity growth. But the problem, for some reasons that I can develop during the discussion, I have so many things to develop to the during the discussion, I hope you're free this afternoon. The problem is the diffusion of innovation from the top companies to the rest of the economy. It seems that, and maybe Japan is not a unique case here, it seems that productivity growth, innovation in top companies is not diffusing well in the rest of the economy. Let me conclude with one additional comment, the impact of inequalities on growth that was emphasized in Michael Spence. Maybe I will be really forced to conclude my talk. Did you plan this? Ah, okay, it's back. What can be the impact of inequalities on growth? First of all, there is something interesting. If you look at Piketty's methodology to analyze inequalities in Japan, you will see that by comparison to the US, which is reported here, the gap between the top 1% and the rest of the economy, Japan is following a French path, so not so important increase of inequality. But when you look at the other at the other side of the distribution, and when you look at the poverty rate, looking at the bottom part of the distribution, you see that the dark line has increased steadily, and it's a unique case among OECD countries. So the story of increasing capital, inequalities in Japan is not a story of capital, it's a story of labor. And very similar, in fact, of what happened in Germany during the last 15 or 20 years, increasing non-regular workers, increasing number of working poor, flat wages, making impossible to walk on two legs for internal demand. So if I conclude my own evaluation of Abenomics, one is that, so what we should praise is that it's an alternative to austerity, as I mentioned in the introduction. It's also very interesting in the attempt to coordinate policies. What I forgot to mention, and I'm sorry, I will just say one word here. In terms of monetary policy, Mr. Abe did not change the constitution. He was lucky enough that the term of the former governor of BAG went to an end at the beginning of Abenomics. So he didn't have to force him to resign. He quit by himself, and it opened the possibility for Abe to nominate a new governor, Mr. Kuroda, very close to his own vision. But many commentators think that if the timing would not have been perfect, certainly Mr. Abe would have really changed the rules of the game. So the case of Abenomics is really for you a case to think about the virtues and the limitation of independence of a central bank. As it works, as you saw, our answer is mixed. But at the same time, we are convinced that it's not just another economic policy failure. And one indirect measurement of this is the fact that Mr. Abe has been regularly re-elected during the last 5 years, despite the opposition of a majority of the Japanese citizens to his non-economic policy, so revising the constitution and so on. So it means that, to some extent, Japanese citizens that are not stupid feel, at least, they experience something that makes them better off than before. Apparently, it was not completely the case in the US or in European countries. Will Abenomics fail? Our answer is a tentative yes, for the reason I just mentioned. I think I will stop here, and I will be very pleased to hear the comment of two of you, and maybe later on the discussion. Thank you very much.
So Maria Luisa and I will discuss the presentation of Sébastien in the next 15 minutes, and we don't have a lot of time, so let's get straight into it. First, Mr. Le Chevalier mentioned some of the peculiarities of Japan. We want to get back to that to kind of illustrate the original situation Japan was in before Abenomics to begin with. Then we will also talk about the international political context of Abenomics and reiterate and summarize the main policy points that are important about Abenomics and what is different about Abenomics. So about the peculiarities of the Japanese economy, it was already mentioned, Japan has a very has very large government debt. It's got the quickest aging population in of any developing country of the world. It's also got a shrinking population, mostly because the fertility rate of Japanese women is similar to Western European countries, but Japan has less immigration than most Western European countries. It's been in a liquidity trap for much of the past 25 years, but it has exited this liquidity trap. And also what is very important to mention, that we also already touched upon, is that Japan has been in regular crises for the past 27 years. So there was the Japanese asset price bubble that burst in 1991. Then there was the Asian financial crisis that we were discussed in 1997, the dot-com bubble in 2001. Then we had the international financial crisis in 2007, 2008. And then we had Fukushima, which also took a hit at GDP growth in 2011. So regular shocks to GDP. And also what I personally found very interesting is it's got a very, very large gender wage gap, the third largest in the world, in fact, and it's a strongly hierarchical society. Just to give this three very quick numbers, about general government debt. So in 2015, that's the latest number from the OECD, Japan had a government debt of 234% here. This is the orange line for those in the back room. This might be hard to see. Below it in gray is Greece. In blue is France, and in yellow is Germany. And you see how vastly different the Japanese government debt is. This is much less of a problem in other countries, however, because of the structure of this debt. 20% as of 2014, 20% of this debt has been held by the Bank of Japan. This has also been expanded since. Then 13% is held by domestic banks, and in general, the overall majority of this debt is held within the country, as opposed to most other Western nations. Then also, just because I found this so very interesting, the gender wage gap. Japan here, the third largest one at the right. Yes, and that's over to international politics.
So it's also important to contextualize Japan within the international scenario, because there was this generalized feeling that of a declining role of Japan in the global environment. And in this context, the main goal of Abe's administration was to restore Japan as a first-class rank power in the global economy. And this is known as a shift from a Yoshida doctrine that was based on a low-profile insertion of Japan in the international scenario to a more active role of the country. And its origin, it's basically the idea of to restore the Japan of the role of Japan in the pre-Second World War as an Asian leader and so on. So this doctrine has some major points. For example, the revision of the Article 5 and 9 of the Constitution, as mentioned by Mr. Le Chevalier, but in the security and geopolitical agenda. But the most relevant for us right now is the foreign trade policy under the Abe doctrines, because the main goal is to strengthen ties with its major trade partner, that is USA. And this can explain also the joining the TPP, even if when the 2002 campaign elections, the Abe's party was contrary to the Japanese insertion in this treaty. The TPP also has an important role to play, because according to the Abe's administration, the TPP would promote it would oblige some domestic restructuring in the economy, and this is important to the third era of policy. So since 2013, there was this common consensus in the international politics of re-raising of Japan as a major player, but also focus on Abe's personalities. And in 2013, in the G8 summit in UK, the Abe's slogan, that is, Japan is back, or Japan back on its feet, was highly credible by all the international community. And so, as you can see here, we have some covers of magazines. So, first one, who is Shinzo Abe? Because it was an unknown figure, despite his grandfather was also a politician in Japan. The second one, what is, it is a bird, it is a planet. No, it's Japan. So this idea of Japan was rising again as a major country in the international scenario. And also, sometimes Abe is classified as a revisionist, as a nationalist, and called as the patriot. But the main point of this slogan is not a more active role in the international scenario, but all the changes in the domestic economic policy of Japan, known as Abenomics. So we are moving to talk about it, and just a brief summary. Abenomic, it means like three arrows, has three arrows. So monetary easing policy, flexible fiscal policy, and structural reforms. The first one is an active quantitative expansionist policy. We are going to talk later, so I will focus just in this qualitative and quantitative easing. The important point here is the qualitative easing, because it implies a major role played by the Bank of Japan in a strong commitment with the monetary policy target and adjusting the people's expectation, and known as as a forward-looking monetary policy plated by some new Keynesians to assure future expectations. A second one is the fiscal policy. And this, we found some papers about some contradiction in this policy, because the policy aims to give us a balance between a fiscal consolidation, especially because of the growing debt of the Japan government, and a fiscal stimulus. So increased consumption tax and a gradual fiscal consolidation. But sometimes they argue that these policies are neutralizing itself. And the third arrow is structural reform. And Ab's interview says that this third arrow is about a growth strategy, which should be led by three concepts: challenge, openness, and innovation. And as professor said before, there is nothing talking about to tackle the problem of diffusion of innovation in Japan. Japan is a really innovative country, even in these new fields, for example, in low carbon emissions technologies and so on, and also have a really good health system. But the real problem is not being tackled, and so on. And we would like to talk about that this the lack of representation in these structural reforms, because these structural reforms has like three major council advisors, and none in these three major council advisors we have representatives of workers and consumers. And especially with workers, because Japan has, we can say that Japan has a really structural problem in the labor market. And in the past, in the first 2 years of Abe's administration, this is a data that we collect, the average average wage work in real terms decreased actually to 2.1%.
Because we only have 15 minutes, we can only get into more detail about one of those arrows, which was monetary easing, because it's the most striking of the three central policies of Abenomics. There's a very interesting speech by the current governor of the Bank of Japan from 2017, by Mr. Kuroda, where he goes into detail about what theories informed the current handling of the Bank of Japan of interest rates and inflation. And in this he argues that the two, which is standard, the two standard explanations for the persistent deflation that Japan has experienced are the decreased natural interest rate, natural interest rate meaning this fictitious interest rate that basically is a flattened real interest rate, and the decrease of inflation expectations. So what Japan did to counteract these two deflationary forces was qualitative and quantitative easing. Now, the difference between this QQE and the QE we've had in the European Union is that the qualitative part emphasizes that trust in the Bank of Japan had to be reestablished. Right, and the reason why Japan had to be a lot more inventive in its monetary policy than we had to be in the European Union is that what we see here, because of the frequent crises that Japan had experienced in the years leading up to the recent financial crisis, and because of the deflation that it was already in, and had already been in a liquidity trap for 15 years at that point. You see here in blue at the very bottom, this is the Japanese overnight rate before the crisis. So here what's encircled, it's a period between 2008 and 2009. And you see all the other, you see the Euro area, the United Kingdom, the United States, you see all of them decreasing their overnight rates in this period. Japan was not able to do this. It was already at the zero lower bound. So Japan had to get creative and had to do a lot more than the other banks did. So what they did is they doubled their money supply within 2 years. In fact, they even more than doubled it for a shorter period. So here the blue line shows is April 2013, which is when Mr. Kuroda, the then new governor of the Bank of Japan, took office. And you see in red the monetary base. In blue and orange below, you see M1 and M2, and you see how the monetary base was heavily expanded over a period of 2 years and has decreased since then. Yes, and we see that that Japan has now exited this period of deflation. You see here in blue is Japan and orange is the OECD. We have this long period of deflation here between 2008 and 2013, and we are now beyond that. So, summarizing, what is different about Abenomics? Three main things. First, it was a coordinated policy mix, meaning that policies in all levels were coordinated by these three councils of representatives. Again, what is really important to mention here is that these councils did not contain any workers' representatives or consumers' representatives, which is also why many studies evaluating the effects of Abenomics have found that they were very pro-business and very much not pro-labor. Second important difference about Abenomics is this very, very large monetary expansion program, doubling the money supply within 2 years. And the third, we would argue, is the strong and largely positive initial media attention to Abenomics, which also influenced market expectations, right? This also was able to influence especially monetary policy. Thank you. So now we want to turn the usual game around a bit, because usually at this point we ask the presenter a couple of questions and then he answers them. But instead we would like to ask you questions. So we do hope that you paid some attention. So our first question is because Mr. Le Chevalier's presentation dealt with the fact of trying to answer, dealt with the question of whether Abenomics was successful or not, right? And he showed how complex a question this is. So our very first question for you is, how do you evaluate such a large scale macro policy? How can you tell if such a policy is successful or not? Question one. Question two, we also heard about this rather ambiguous independence of the Japanese central bank. So the large reforms and this very interesting monetary policy that is an important part of Abenomics would never have been possible if the old governor of the Bank of Japan had stayed in office. So it was very lucky timing, or if the lucky timing hadn't been there, Mr. Abe would have had to change the constitution. So the question here is, Abenomics would never have, probably not have been this successful if they hadn't been able to coordinate monetary and fiscal policies. The question is, should central banks always be independent? What are the conditions under which it might be advisable for central banks to not be entirely independent? And the third question is, Abe's efforts, and especially in monetary policy, were very much guided by the fact that he became a very popular figure, right? You saw the Time covers, especially my favorite superhero, Mr. Abe. And this helped them along a lot, right? And the question is whether governments should try and generally advertise their policies or their new policy mixes to try and generate more media attention this way. So, any answers to our questions?
This is the first time you try to do so?
Yes.
Okay, so maybe that's why they were.
They're unused to it.
Okay.
Let me try. Sorry, it's Eric from option A. So we're on the innovation option. And let me try my hands on your first question about how we, I think it's interesting how, at least in the presentation, we're seeing how the Abenomics is contrasted against the other contemporaries at that time, especially when it was launched. And I think it provides a good springboard on how we should be evaluating these macro policies, not just against the target set when it was initially launched, but also against the performance of its contemporaries like the US and France. And at the same time, give a little room with the other with the overall macroeconomic environment that's often outside the hands of the people who promote such policies.
Benedict, option B from Germany. First of all, thank you, Victoria, for kind of mixing this up. I like it. Second of all, I want to go to your first question. Was it successful? And by that, also go to your second, how to evaluate it. I think if we talk about economic policy, we need to talk about politics, and therefore one very easy metric to evaluate was it successful or not is, does the guy get, or the woman get, reelected? And if they do, then they probably were successful, and that points at something that we as economists should always have in the back of our mind. Economic policy can be a very powerful tool to push through other agendas. And if this TINA, there is no alternative, will all get us crashed and burned if we don't think about that. Because that guy, Abe, apparently understood that if I keep the people just moderately happy, and that means out of unemployment, physically moderately happy, I can do my other goals. And we see that, and at this point in Europe, we see that with populism, maybe even fascism. If they weaponize, so to speak, economic policy to reach other goals, they will be able to do that. And in that back, and then I'm going to wrap up, on that we should also look at Trump, and we all think, oh, he's such a failure. He might not be such a failure, and he might actually get reelected, not because he's helping everyone, but he's definitely taking care of his core constituencies. If we look at, for example, what he's doing with protectionism, which is very focused, so a lot of people will keep on suffering, but not the people who will fight for him and vote for him. So on that, I think Abe was pretty successful, and we should always look at if they get reelected. Thank you.
I would take two more and then give Mr. Le Chevalier the opportunity to answer.
Okay. Kasper, option B. I will try to answer the second question. Now, I don't have any economic arguments for this, but my answer is no. Because why? Why would central banks be different from any other part of government and be exempt from democracy? I mean, why would we leave part of the economy out of democracy? That's just stupid.
Laila, you have a question.
Hello, I'm Laila from Argentina. In the development option here. I was thinking in the third question, and it made me think a lot of Lula in Brazil, and in a very different context, but he also got a lot of media attention, and I do think it's a good strategy, taking into account how markets function and how it's all about expectations. But also I have the question, if the media, especially at the global level, helps you when you have a structural reform agenda. So they show Casio as the example to follow, was the case of Argentina also for many years during the 90s. And if when you are actually doing bold fiscal policies, then they would turn their back into you. So that can be tricky because it's not you who get to decide. You can have a strategy as a government of how do you want to show yourself, but then it's also, if for the mainstream it's not convenient to show you as an example, then you are criticized and so on and so forth.
Thank you. And with that, the word is back to Mr. Le Chevalier.
Yes.
So want us to leave this up?
Yes, it's good. It's good. Maybe I can stand. Yes, if. So first of all, thank you very much for your own presentation, and I found it very interesting. Maybe more precise than mine in many respects, and you understood very well some points. So thank you very much, and congratulations. So I will try to review also to try to give my own answer to your three questions and maybe to continue the debate with you. Before that, I was just implicit, so let me be very explicit on this. So I mentioned that in the mid-80s, studying Japan was really maybe an advice given to ambitious PhD candidate to get the light of the best journal and just review. You would be surprised if you look at the issues of American Economic Review at that time, the number of papers that were published, again, of course, from a US perspective on monetary policy, Keiretsu, industrial structure, and so on. And my point is that today, of course, it's less fashionable, but the example of Abenomics, I hope, convince you that maybe you will not engage yourself, all of you, in a PhD on Japan, but there should be a growing interest, especially among you who are interested in economic policy, to look more precisely in what happened in Japan during the 5 years, but even to have a more longer perspective on the trajectory of this country, which is a leading country with different institutions, but similar problems, and maybe also different answers to the problems that other OECD countries are facing. Then, I have nothing to add regarding the first point because I hope, yes, my own presentation show how difficult it is to evaluate economic experience as Abenomics. Of course, there is very simple and provocative answer to say, just look if he or she is reelected or not, and you will see. I think maybe it's very far from you, but it's, I think, a very good example of what happened in France between 1997 and 2002. At that time, we had a prime minister called Mr. Jospin, and for many economists, in 2001, his economic policy was considered as a success. And objectively, the economy was growing again, so the atmosphere was very positive. And Mr. Jospin himself was absolutely sure that he would be elected as the next president of the French Republic. And OECD was really in all the annual report between 1998 and 2002 was celebrating this new type of policy by Prime Minister who was socialist, but very close in inspiration from Schroeder and Tony Blair. The result, and still I believe that it has been quite successful economic policy in many respects. The result has been that for the first time ever, Mr. Le Pen, the father of the infamous Marine Le Pen, was present at the second round of the presidential election. So following your criterion, it's really the sign that this economic policy by Jospin was not so successful. So of course, when you enter into the discussion, you see that the number of votes was in fact so close, and politics is sometimes also does not help always to identify whether economic policy is successful or not. Many other elements enter into the vote of voters. Economic policy is one thing, but as you know, there is a perception, but there are other phenomena, position towards migrants or situation of political institutions. So I would be a little careful, but it's a good way to summarize the difficulty we have in evaluating such kind of policy. Also, again, the dominant, the common wisdom nowadays is to say, at least it's a failure or it's not a success. So it depends, because definitely there were two targets, price dynamics and growth rate. Growth rate is getting better these days, but still fragile. But price dynamics, we are still far from the target. So just this example, and we could continue the debate for many hours, is just a call to be modest but careful and to think about this very common exercise for economists to evaluate policies. I think it's very important, but we need again to be careful. Then, and if you want, of course, to reply, and please do so. As for the independence of central bank, don't go too fast. Of course, I have exactly the same position than you. It's incredible that an institution which is in charge of something as important as monetary policy does not have to report to in a democratic way to citizens. It's absolutely incredible. Maybe in 50 years, people will look at this period between the late 20th century, early 21st century. We look at this period, we'll be reading the writing of economists and say they were crazy. So it was really post-fascist period or something like that. But when you go back, you try to look more carefully at the literature which has tried to promote the independence of central bank. And this literature has its roots in the history of economic thought. It's not a new idea, but it's true that from the 70s, gradually, also some central banks were already independent, the independence has become more formal, and they were good argument to be sure, given by economists, to avoid manipulation of interest rate or money for political interest. So following the argument of your friend and colleague, are we completely satisfied in the case of a government which is doing very aggressive monetary policy without any economic reason, just for political reason, to be sure that it will be re-elected and start this policy 6 months before the election? You heard about some things, the literature, for example, developed by Alesina and others about political cycles, connecting economic cycle and political cycle. I think the story is more complicated, and like you, as a citizen, I cannot believe that we do not, as citizens, we don't have a word to say about monetary policy, but the practice in the past was not completely satisfying, and we should have a more, introduce into more complex argument regarding the independence of the central bank. Abenomics and what preceded Abenomics, to me, is a good case to discuss very seriously about the condition of independence of a central bank. So I think there is not yet a consensus. The debate is really lively, but maybe not enough yet to evaluate the policy by BOJ between 1997 and and until the revival of Kuroda and Abenomics, but clearly it has been counterproductive, and for almost 20 years, the BOJ never reached its objective in terms of price dynamics. So it's clearly a failure, and even more importantly, the BOJ policies had certainly a very negative impact on other output, so like GDP, because of a lack of coordination. So I think we need to have this debate. We need to ask to adopt your position regarding independence of central bank and democracy, but there will be many counter arguments to what you said. So I think it's worth discussing and looking at what happened in Japan as a very interesting case. Last point, I'm not completely surprised you mentioned this in your presentation. I would not, let me try to go a little against your argument. First, it's true completely, and still it's a mystery for me that the advisor of Abe, the group surrounding Abe, have been very good in marketing this economic policy and even in creating the concept of Abenomics. So really, the purpose in this seminar is not to enter into the detail of Japanese politics and the personality of Abe, but let me try to find the equivalent in another country. You mentioned the case of Lula, but Lula, I mean, if I'm working for a marketing company, I would say Lula is relatively easy to do a good marketing with him, but with poor Mr. Abe, he has nothing for him. And don't forget that he was prime minister in 2006. He stayed only 6 months. It was a total disaster. So I don't know who did the marketing. They did it well. And generally speaking, Japanese are very good in many things, but marketing is not their specialty. Marketing, maybe at some point in the 80s, you were not born, they were very good for the marketing of Sony was very good. So everybody was dreaming about Sony. So who is knowing Sony? When you go to supermarket today, what kind of product by Sony you can find? So they are not good, and it's still a mystery. So this master is, as far as I know, a master of economics, so not a master of marketing. So I would not engage myself too much in this way, but it's still a surprise. And I don't know who is responsible for this marketing of Abenomics, but maybe he or she does not deserve the Nobel Prize of Economics, but at least a prize in marketing, because it was not an easy task. It was not an easy task. With Lula, I think I can do it by myself. Obama, the same, no problem. And Trump, in a sense, it's possible to tell a story about Trump, in a sense. It's a good, So, but one thing is important in what you said, and it's a more general concern, and it can be a topic for research, is the importance of communication. And there are several papers on this particular topic that can be extended. The key topic is the way governments talk to markets. And what are the tools they have to convince markets that their policy is a good policy? And clearly, in the current economic context, if you do a good policy, we don't know what is a good policy, and I hope you're convinced of this, but let's imagine whatever policy you do, if you're not able to communicate to markets, to convince them that you're doing a right policy which will increase growth and also increase the return on assets, you be sure that you, whatever the policy you will do, it will be a failure. You will not be able to reach your targets. What is impressive in the case of Abe, that imagine any Argentinian government trying to do what he did. The day after, Argentina is back to bankrupt. So this policy is not a responsible policy. It's not a problem of Argentina, it's a problem of credibility, of power of ideas. I don't know how to call it. But to try to be back to what he did, it's irresponsible policy. It's for the consensus of financial market, it's not acceptable, it's very dangerous. Few people were saying this, and in fact, as far as I know, Japan is not yet in bankrupt, and again, it's not a complete failure, but the rather than marketing to citizens, what is interesting is the way with his supporters, of course, and it did not come from even, it was well prepared. He has been able to do a kind of heterodox economic policy, so much perceived as heterodox that in the French context, but also in the US, in Europe, Abenomics was supported by people who are rather on the left of the political scale. And I include myself in this. So it's quite a paradox to see economists fighting against the policy of European Union and European Central Bank, and finding in Abe, a guy at the extreme right, an example of heterodox economic policy. And heterodox policy, economic policy, which is not criticized by market, which is rather accepted. Look at the evolution of the Nikkei index. So this point, I would say, I would not follow the idea of marketing. I don't know. I have no explanation, just to say congratulations, because it was not easy to market, to do a good marketing on Abe. But just the paradox that this, imagine Greek government trying to do this kind of policy. You know the result immediately. So I want to hear your opinion on this. I have no idea how it's possible, except maybe people like Frédéric Lordon may tell a beautiful story on the power of ideas. But it's quite interesting to try to understand how it has been possible. This is what I wanted to add to your question.
Thank you very much. So now we should open the floor for questions. Maybe I will take three for questions first.
As many as you
will. Please. So Carmen, Brenda, and Anka.
Thank you. I'm Carmen from Option B. I'm from Germany. And one minor comment on whether central banks should be independent. I would say how they are currently framed as independent, they pretend to be impolitical, while they are definitely not. So independence could be that the central bank is independent of the current governing sector, which can grant stability and can therefore be desirable, and would limit power, so to say. However, it depends on the goal set by the central bank, which
exactly.
could be employment.
Problem of
One point we have not touched upon is culture, and I think I'm not an expert on Japanese culture, but Victoria has mentioned it's a quite hierarchical society. I've heard the same, and I imagine that people are quite resilient to non-changes, to non-innovation, so they may accept decreasing or stagnating wages more than the French do, but I'm not sure on this. Maybe you can mention the cultural aspects a bit. And finally, I would be interested in the womenomics programs pursued by Abe. Thank you.
Thank you very much for the presentation. It was really interesting. I'm Brenda from Option A, from Innovation. One of my questions was in line with women economics. That I would like to know, because I was really surprised when I was studying the women's participation in research, That in while in most developed countries, more or less it was on average 30%. In the case of Japan, was like 13%, which is really very low. My second question is about, well, you talked about this rise of or this lack of diffusion of innovation to the rest of the economy as one of the causes of the problems in growth. I would like to ask about the policies to encourage this diffusion of innovation.
Good afternoon. My name is Adger Nizar and I am from Indonesia. And thank you once again for your presentation. And I would like to also chip in into the question of the central bank's independence and offer the uncontroversial opinion that I am not agree with how it should be independent, especially in the case of Japan, because I think that independence of central bank is something that should only be limited to those countries that have to have them. And Japan is not included in that situation, in my opinion. If we are talking about my country, Indonesia, then I agree completely that it should be independence in Indonesia, because we would be transforming into a banana country in just like few days if the central bank is not independent. But in the case of Japan, I think it has a sufficient amount of credibility and also a sufficient amount of vision, coordinated vision from the side of the government and from the side of the central bank, that I think that it can be not independent in that way. And I also think, related to that question as well, 2019 there will be the planned reform of the VAT once again, and considering that actually we seem to agree that the Central Bank of Japan can afford to not become independent, my question is that is there still a sense of urgency in carrying out this tax reform? Because we also see how the demand structure in Japan in 2014 was severely disrupted by the tax reform, and it plunged the economy back into a recession, a short deep recession. So considering that the Bank of Japan can actually afford not to become independent, and also considering the fact that more or less practically Bank of Japan has been monetizing the debt of Japan government for quite some time, is there still some urgency to carry out this tax reform in your opinion? And perhaps one also small question on top of that is that, can you chip in more into your opinion on where is the inflation in Japan, considering that the full employment has been going on for quite some time, and it is quite striking that there is an issue of deflation rather than inflation for quite some time in Japan. So what is your opinion on that? Thank you.
So maybe you can answer now, and then we take a second round later.
Okay. Thank you very much for your different questions. Let me try to follow the order. Alors, normally, it's believe my own 20 years experience of receiving questions on the Japanese economy. There should be one question on Japanese culture. it's really if it does not happen, I consider that people did not hear me or really are not interested at all in. So the way I answer is, if you go to Japan and you will see people walking in the subway, or you will see people jumping in the train, the fact it's so well organized, within 5 minutes they can complete the boarding of a plane, while in France it takes 30 minutes, and so on. So there are some, obviously it's a country where the culture is different, and at more individual level, unfortunately, this year there is no Japanese student, and it's very rare that there is a Japanese student in this master. But if you meet Mr. Tanaka, you will, I don't know who is Mr. Tanaka, but typical name, you will see that his attitude will be very different, the way he asks a question and so on will be different. So they are culturally different. Then, to connect these cultural differences to macroeconomic outcome, until now, I have been never convinced. Maybe you might convince me from today, but I never read any article or book convincing me that they can explain some features of the Japanese economy by this cultural characteristic. And precisely your point, so maybe in the Japanese culture, there is a strong sense of hierarchy, so people will be very obedient and they will not, they will be very satisfied with the the rice they get every day, that's it. Believe me, in the past, recent political life in Japan, what I call recent is, for example, post-war or during 68 events, there were very strong movements against political leaders, economic leaders, and so on. It's true that these days, especially after Fukushima, people were really angry against what happened, and there were some demonstrations, and there were, from a Japanese perspective, a gigantic demonstration, but they were maybe even according to the organizers themselves. I'm not citing the numbers by the police. There were maybe 10,000 people in the street, which is nothing. So I agree. So there are other ways to demonstrate dissatisfaction, including changing the government every year and so on. So I would not follow this explanation, and we will be back to the key question that was asked at the end regarding how to explain low inflation near the full employment. This is I would not find any cultural explanation in this, and this is a key question, and I have absolutely no explanation, just maybe some hypothesis. Womenomics and the situation of women. In fact, participation of women on the labor market globally, if you look at the participation between 16 years old and 59, and you can compare OECD statistics, you will see that the participation of women in Japan is higher than in France. Much higher than in Italy, it's closer to Canada, so it's about, contrary to what you said, 75% and 77%. And we can check immediately the OECD data.
But I was referring not to the global market in general, I was referring specifically to research.
But generally speaking, because I'm answering about womenomics. And so the situation is not so much a problem of women participation on the labor market, because it's relatively high, but it's high by OECD standard. But what is problematic is the shape. Yeah? So in fact, contrary to France, for example, people will start working much earlier, and they will continue to work much later than in France, where the working age is much more restricted. And in the case of women, the problem is the pattern of their career, the case in Japan. So in many cases, and it, you said in your presentation, the demographic picture of Japan should take into account the lack of migration and also the very high life expectancy. Nonetheless, fecundity rate is among the lowest in OECD countries. And one reason is that basically Japanese society, and I'm not talking about Japanese culture, I'm talking about Japanese current society, did not find a way to propose a good balance between private life and working life. So it's a general problem that affects men and that affects women, and in the Japanese context, it translates directly into a very a decrease of the fecundity rate. Basically, if you are a woman and you want to have children, you will have to quit your job, whatever, with the exception of civil servants, but you will face a very bad relationship with your coworker, and with the exception of the academic world, where it's maybe one of the careers still where you can combine family life and having babies and a career. but which is dramatically affected in terms of promotion, in terms of publication, like in France, by the way, but much more in Japan. So basically what happened in Japan, this is what we call the M curve, which is becoming flat, more flat these days, but which is very typical of some Asian countries. So basically, women enter the labor market relatively early. First top by age bracket, I look at the participation of women by age bracket. The first top is around 25 years old, then there is a drop and a new top when they are 45 or 50 years old, when the children are raised and they can go back on the labor market. But you can imagine, after 15 or 20 years break, they go as part-time workers, very below their education and their skills, the skills they had before they left the labor market. So basically, officially, womenomics is trying to solve this problem and to create a better balance between working life and family life. And Mr. Abe set a very ambitious target, but sorry, I read many reports, and it's really boring, but I try to understand, and I did not see, in this case, how we will reach the targets. So, Mr. Abe, where are your nurseries? Where is your budget for family policy? It's out of the focus of this presentation, but you should know that the Japanese welfare system, in terms of public and private spending, is approximately at the same level than France if you focus on pension and health expenditure. Okay, but as soon as you add, of course, unemployment benefits, we are a global champion in France, so of course nobody can compete with us. And my point is not to cut unemployment benefits, we need to increase them. Just we have so many unemployed people, of course it's not comparable. But most characteristic of the French situation is family policy. We have, sometimes for bad reason, but for many, for more than one century, we have a family policy. And we have a public spending. You may consider it's not enough, but by comparison to Japan, it makes the difference between the two countries. And I'm not convinced by the policy of Abe. He's just setting a target. And poor Mr. Abe, he had a problem of coordination in his own government. He appointed several women, but a very limited number, very far from 50%, of course. And two of them said, few weeks after the beginning of Abenomics, basically they said more or less that the right place for women is in their kitchen. So then it's true that it's difficult. Then is it cultural or not? No, they are just very conservative and so on. Let me, there are two more questions. It's okay, still? So one, very important to me, I'm very interested in it, concerns diffusion of innovation. I forgot who asked the question on diffusion. You. So it's a very good question. So it's not what I show you, the increasing productivity gap is not proper to Japan. You can find several papers showing the same pattern from the 90s in the UK, in France. But in the Japanese case, it's particularly dramatic, and especially the increase is particularly dramatic. In the past, in the 50s, Japanese economy was very well known for its productivity gap between small companies and large companies. And it was really, according to some report, one of the most dramatic cases. These days, the problem is what we did. So we look at manufacturing industry. We did the same for non-manufacturing. It works as well. And we found increasing productivity gap for companies of similar size and belonging to the same narrowly defined sectors. And so it's not a problem of sector. It's not a problem of size. This is what I call a problem of diffusion of innovation. So what does it mean? First, in Japan, like in many other countries, the policy during the last 20 years has been to make intellectual property rights much stronger. They were very loose, which is understandable for a country which is in the catching up process. But as soon as Japan reached the technology frontier in many sectors from the late 80s, we may understand why protecting intellectual property rights was important. But it corresponds also to some ideological called development, and to me, it has not been so fruitful. So what kind of policy we propose is to increase spillovers in the economy. So there are various ways to increase spillovers in the economy, but what is certainly in the end of the government is to also, of course, it has a micro impact, and I cannot tell you what will be the macro impact of this, but to create, for example, for some specific industries, technologies, or topics, our research and development consortia, when you put different companies in the same consortia, of course, they are private companies. Government cannot force Honda, Toshiba to enter. But to create the incentive to gather and follow some topics, some technology, will certainly, at the level of a technology, promote the convergence and the spillovers. What we found, in fact, in the study I show you, we try to explain why we observe increasing productivity dispersion. We found that the introduction, contrary to what we expected, the introduction, and I can send you the paper if you are interested, contrary to what we expected, the introduction of new technology is not the major source of increasing productivity gap between companies. The major source is internationalization. And in the Japanese case, maybe you are aware of this literature, there is a combination of selection effect and learning effect. Selection effect has been recognized to explain major stylized fact, the fact that exporting companies are, on average, much more productive than non-exporting companies. What has been shown in the literature, and there are 10,000 papers on it, is that there is a kind of self-selection process, and the most productive firm go on the global market. But what we found, which is not found in for all countries in the Japanese case, is a kind of substantial learning effect. So companies who go to the global market will become even more productive. They are learning, maybe marketing, but also making better product and so on. So it creates a gap between good companies or productive companies and the rest of the economy. So I go back. Emergency of a tax reform, yes, there is a problem, and the debate on the tax reform in Japan is terrible. I just have an anecdote. Maybe you know. So I was lucky enough to be with Piketty when he presented his book in Japan for the first time, and he was welcomed, like the Beatles were welcome in the 60s in Japan. People were not opening their shirts, but it was almost like this. There were some guards in front of his bedroom in the hotel. But this success was basically concerning the first part of the book, documenting increasing inequalities. The second part of the book, which is how do we do to reduce inequalities, which is related to tax reform, people were just not hearing what he had to say, so it was Japanese style, complete silence. He was so excited to talk about tax reform. What you talk about tax reform is also to reduce public debt and so on. And clearly, the increase of public deficit in Japan is very similar to the strategy followed by some US government in the early 80s. Increase your public deficit to be sure that nobody will have the idea to increase social spending, public social spending. We don't have money anymore, so sorry, we cannot do anything for you, and especially we will not be able to reduce inequalities through a tax reform. Alors, issue of low inflation, near full employment, one hypothesis is just because of Japanese culture, people are so obedient, they are satisfied with low wage, they will never fight. So I explained briefly, it doesn't seem to be the case to me. One thing, I think, so I don't have a comprehensive, fully satisfying story. But let me give you only one hypothesis I like and I would like to promote in my own research. The way wages were increased in the past in Japan was done through a very specific institutional framework called Shunto, S-H-U-N-T-O. And this Shunto was a kind of form of collective bargaining and at the level of a sector within a company, because you know that so union maybe are relatively weaker than in France and in Germany, but a characteristic in Japan is that union are company-based. There are some umbrellas, but they are weak, and the center of the power of unions are at the company level. And I think we are all concerned by this point. I would define the Japanese union system and bargaining system as even more decentralized than the US one. And this is what we are trying to do in France and maybe later on in other European countries. The best way to keep wages stagnant and flat is to reduce the bargaining power of union. And in a decentralized system, contrary to what is said these days, the workers do not have the bargaining power to do counter proposition to their employers and to the employers' association, which is heterogeneous but much more coordinated. So basically, decentralization is the enemy of bargaining power for workers. This decentralized system did exist in Japan in the past, but it was corrected by this institutional device called Shunto. And despite the decentralized characteristic, union companies were forced to coordinate, to discuss together about wage increase. And not because today is raining or because tomorrow it will be sunny, they were trying to share information about productivity increase, about the situation of their respective companies. This system has been destroyed systematically during the last 30 years. It was really a target of Japanese employer association, and maybe unions have also their responsibility. Result, the bargaining power to bargain for a wage increase is at the lowest. You have, I can continue for next 2 hours. So, but is it 2 minutes or 2 hours? Two minutes, okay. So really, to me, a part of the explanation, and I could send you one paper on it, is on the relationship between wage increase and price increase, and connecting to the wage bargaining power variable, which is an outcome of institutional story rather than desperating cultural characteristic.
Okay, I think we should have time for one more round. So, Luisa and Luca and Leila. Okay.
Hi, I'm Luisa from Option A of Innovation. Thank you very much for your very enriching presentation. First of all, a very brief question. I would just like to ask you to go deeper in the structural reforms during the Abenomics, please. And second, regarding aging as an important issue in Japan, I would like to know if and how Japan tackles this problem, increasing fertility rates, but also trying to include the elderly in the economy. And if you could maybe connect these also to unemployment and wages, like the trial.
Sorry, I missed a point. So your question is about womenomics, and if the goal is to increase fecondity rate or
if there is also a trial to include the elderly in the economy,
okay.
And how and what is the impact of it?
Okay. Okay.
My name is Luca. I'm also from the Innovation Option. First of all, thank you very much for your presentation. I found it especially really interesting, the change of structure of the productivity gap. However, there was one point that puzzled me a bit. It was that you said there's no real mention of environmental economics in Abenomics, and I was puzzled by how was that possible 1 year after 2011, and was the impact maybe on the German economy bigger than
definitely.
On the Japanese economy?
Definitely.
Maybe you could take a point on that.
Mm.
I would like to follow up a bit on the discussion on how we generate spillovers or not in innovation. And I don't know if you have heard about William Lazonik, this American economist who is arguing that one of the reasons why companies are not innovating is because there are no incentives for workers to innovate, mm-hmm. as the wages are decreasing, mm-hmm. and there are no targeting specifically knowledge workers so as to innovate. If that is, I would like to know if you think that maybe one of the reasons behind this in Japan, also adding up to what the one you already mentioned. Mm.
Thanks. That's it. I think maybe you should keep answering between 10 minutes.
Yes, I keep a look.
Thank you very much.
At the time. So structural reform under Abenomics. Before this, briefly, I should tell you that from the early 80s, gradually, in Japan, you had never any Margaret Thatcher or Ronald Reagan or Gerhard Schroeder. Last one is, of course, no. You had never this kind of politician, but nonetheless, from the early 80s, gradually, financial markets were liberalized from very early stage where they were controlled on exchange rate and so on. So gradually, it has been gradual, but nonetheless, very steady. Goods markets were liberalized. In the case of goods market, I think it has been substantial also, but there were some exceptions. So for example, in the drug sector, so the companies like Takeda and others were strong enough to force giants like Pfizer and other multinationals to make their test again, specifically in the case of Japan. So they had, the test for a new drug, how long it takes, and you can normally do it at the global level, but through some regulation, Ministry of Health in Japan is very good at this, they were forced to do the test, to give time enough to their Japanese competitor to create the same drug at a lower cost. And so it's true. So there are some exceptions, but nonetheless, good markets have been liberalized before Abenomics. And the same for labor market. There were some restrictions for layoff, for the use of what they call non-regular employees, and it has been liberalized around the 2000. So what left for Mr. Abe, I would say very very limited measures. So it's not, they are not dramatic change, but this is the limited reform, like Mr. Macron, when Mr. Macron creates a new, so relax the rule regarding the bus. So I don't know if it will be in the textbook of history after 50 years as the one who increased the number of buses on the French highways, but the type of reform introduced by Mr. Abe are relatively similar, with few exceptions. One is deregulation of international trade. So of course, Japan was already engaged into global bargaining and had already several few trade agreements. But with the engagement in Trans-Pacific Partnership, he went even further. And as you know, they talk a lot about TPP, but he concluded also an agreement with Europe as well. In terms of corporate governance, there are several technical reforms that have been introduced regarding the way so the board should be, the composition of the board and so on. So external, the criteria to define external auditor to be sure that in Japanese companies there are enough representative of outside. So I could continue. Corporate tax also has been reformed, but to be decreased, of course. We are in Japan, and several reforms like this. So they were, I would say, more technical reforms than huge reforms that were already introduced in the past. As for elderly people, yes, of course, this is one key policy of Abenomics that started before. The target is to create the condition to extend working life beyond what you may consider as reasonable. And if you go to Tokyo one day, and if you have the opportunity to take a taxi, you will be, so normally they are polite and sometimes more competent than in Paris, but you will be surprised that you will see your grandfather driving you in the street of Tokyo, somebody very small, very aged. It's sometimes a little scary, but this is a type of that many elderly people can find when their pension is not enough. You can see them also in other position. So basically, it's a very proactive policy, which is followed by many governments all around the world, to governments that are trying to, who are dreaming to find a definitive solution to our pension problem. I don't think it's a dream solution, but this is a fact, and sometimes quite surprising. Environmental policy, I forgot, you asked the question about environmental policy. I'm surprised as you are. So clearly the trajectory of Japan and Germany is fascinating after Fukushima. So Germany reacted, and Japan reacted also because they closed down all the nuclear plant. But then the agenda for the nuclear lobby and for some other group was to reopen them. So at this stage, only three of them are reopened, but it's just a matter of time, and they will reintroduce. So then, I would say, so my conclusion is the power of nuclear lobby in Japan is at least as strong as in France, at least. And also, there is certainly a problem with democracy, because definitely when you have some surveys, when you ask to people, should we get rid of nuclear power, 70-80% answer yes, but it's not enforced. So what has been done in terms of environmental policy, and it was quite impressive. So for more than 1 year after Fukushima, when you enter the ministries, I had the opportunity to visit the Ministry of Economy several times, it was completely dark. And so it was shut down. So, but again, it's a way to reduce consumption of electricity, and it was very much followed. So in a department store in Japan, you will see 20 elevators going very fast, very soft, made by Toshiba and so on. And for 2 years, half of them were stopped in order to save electricity. Now they have restart with different means. But yes, I'm afraid they are missing. Also, of course, many actors, many players are trying to invest in new forms of renewable energy. And maybe there will be some surprise in the coming years, but not as much as we may have expected. And I think it's more, but maybe the contribution of Japan, besides my funny or not funny story about dark ministries, is energy saving. There is a sense of frugality. A company like Toyota is very good at this, reducing the cost of production, reduction. I think there were some innovations that may explain why they have no problem to meet the target of Paris Agreement, COP 21. Spillover of the economy, my answer will be short. Yes, certainly. This is a good argument, creating incentive for workers to innovate. But it was discussed in Japan, and it was understood in the Silicon Valley way. So everybody should be able to create his or her own company. And for some reason, that would be too long to explain, and I don't want somebody show me that. In fact, so the number of startups, of creation of startups, is limited. And there are various obstacles, and the attempt to mimic the Silicon Valley in Japan has been a failure. So unfortunately, incentive for workers to innovate has been understood in a very restrictive way, and this is maybe a part of the explanation within the company, and it may explain the trajectory of a company like Sony, for example.
So thank you very much for your presentation. Thank you all as well. And we see each other in the afternoon. Thank you very much.
Thank you.